Don't you find dumb that in every presentation of a new product, they always go with, "This is the best whatever we have ever made." Well, I hope so. I don't think any company is working to make their product worse. But with newer CPUs for phones, that argument is not so clear. As we have seen previously, it is impossible to take full advantage of the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1 without active cooling. And while on Apple's court, the situation is not so complicated, they also sometimes get you with this screen. In this video, we're going to test the Black Shark BR30-AP, a magnetic Peltier cooler for the iPhone and Android. Let's see how much it helps improve the performance of these phones, and if it can rescue the Galaxy S22 from the inferno that is the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1. Welcome back, I'm Claudio, and this is Zero to Tech. Okay, on the last video, we saw that the Galaxy S22, once hot, barely outperforms older phones. And you may think, I bought this cooler to solve that, but in truth, I was not thinking about the S22, games or Android. In fact, I bought it because with the heatwave, my iPhone began to overheat while recording these videos. And it showed me the awful screen that doesn't let you do anything until the phone cools down. So after several trips to the freezer, and after last week's Galaxy S22 review, I bought it to try and kill two birds with the same stone. When looking for options, this was one of the first that grabbed my attention. Specifically, because it can be stuck onto the iPhone using the MagSafe magnet. It also includes a magnetic plate in case you wanted to stick it to another phone. And with this, you can skip any other clip system. Also, because Black Shark is a brand with quite a bit of experience making coolers. The box is not very big, and inside, you can immediately see the cooler. We pick it up and see that it is not as light as it seems. Below, there is the plate that we're going to use for the Galaxy. In an extra box, we have a USB-C to USB-C cable that feels pretty good, and a small manual. The design is very simple but quite attractive. From behind, we can clearly see the fan. We have an LED that sits exactly above the USB-C port used to power it. You can see that it is not as big as the GameSeer X3 fan, and the contact surface is not that big either. But it also uses a Peltier cooler, which uses a semiconductor that uses power to move temperature from one side to the other. If we plug it and look at the thermal camera, we can see that the cooling starts immediately. In less than 1 minute, the surface temp drops from 28 to only 12 degrees. We even have condensation on the contact surface. All that heat must go somewhere, so that's where the fan and the heat sink come in, sending it to the air. For it to work, you must connect it to a power source. You can power it from your phone, but it uses 2 amps at 5 volts, so I wouldn't recommend it, because it will kill your battery. As we discussed in the extra video, it's an effective technology but not very efficient. Now, all this cooling is useless if it cannot be transferred to the phone, so we're going to try first with the iPhone and then we will see if it can rescue the Galaxy S22. Black Shark markets this cooler specifically for the iPhone, and you can see why. Putting it on is quick and easy. You just stick it to the back and it positions itself. Apple does a great job with magnets, and Black Shark took this opportunity to make it very simple, and it holds quite strong. No doubt the cooler makes good contact with the phone, but perhaps the position is not ideal. The hottest spot on the iPhone is just below the cameras, where the CPU is, so the phone will have to move the heat to the cooler. And we start with a quick pass of well-known benchmarks, starting with Geekbench, where it gave us a result without cooler of 1584 in single core and 4170 in multi-core. Then with the cooler, 1591 single and 4206 multi. In both cases, a difference of less than 1%. Now to test the graphics, we used Wildlife Extreme. And without the cooler, the iPhone gave us a result of 2461 points against 2497 with it. This is a 1.5% difference. And finally, in AnTuTu, which tests everything, gave us a result of 745,000 without the fan versus 750,000 with it. Again, a difference of 1%. The cooler is clearly better by a mile. I would say if I was in politics, but in reality they are almost identical. And within the margin of error. So, is it useless? Should we throw it away? Obviously no. These type of tests are usually very fast and hardly allow the phone to heat up. But when we play, we usually do it for more than 30 minutes. That's much more demanding on the phone. And there is where the difference really is. So let's use Wildlife Extreme again, but this time in a stress test, which run it 20 times in a row. Here, we can see how the scores from the second round start to drop down. And the average, instead of being around 2500 points, it's around 1800 points. Also, the difference between the fastest and the slowest execution gives us the stability percentage, which is 70%. Not much to brag about. Now, we do the same test with the cooler, and we see a change. The average stops being around 1800, and is closer to 1950. And the slower run is clearly in line with the average. This gave us a stability of 77%. As you can see on the graph, once it balanced out, the performance remains more stable. Now, how does this translate to games? Unfortunately, the iPhone has no way to show us game statistics. And since there is no Fortnite, thanks to the fight between Apple and Epic, we do not have a game that can push the phone to the limit and has a frame counter. There are other ways, but they require additional software, a Mac, and it's too much of a hassle. So we used Genshin Impact and tried to see if there was a difference to the naked eye. We first set the graphics to the max and raised it to 60 FPS. Then played it for 20 minutes without the cooler, taking advantage that this game does support controller on iOS. And the truth is that it is difficult to say if the performance drops. After 20 minutes, it still feels perfect. And with the cooler the same, I could tell you that the difference is noticeable, but I will be lying to you. There are places where the weather is much hotter. Maybe there the difference is clear, but here it feels the same. Something I can tell you is that the specific reason I bought the fan, which was to being able to record for a long period without the phone crashing, hasn't happened to me again. Without the cooler, while recording, the phone heats up to almost 43 degrees, and it's around this temperature that it suddenly locks up. But with the cooler, it never goes over 40. Then, first problem solved. Okay, now to test it in the Android court, we have the Galaxy S22 Plus that we saw last week. The conclusion for the review was simple. The Snapdragon 8 Gen 1 has an amazing performance, but inside the Galaxy, it gets so hot that it can barely outperform the Snapdragon 865. That makes it a perfect candidate for this accessory. Putting it on isn't as easy because it obviously doesn't have the same magnets as the iPhone, but they do include a plate that you can stick to your phone. That works as an anchor point for the cooler. Since we have the freedom to choose where to put it, we're going to set it as close as possible to the hottest point of the phone, even if it doesn't look centered. And once the plate is on, it doesn't take up enough space to get in the way of the case. Not bad. Just be careful when removing the cooler, because on more than one occasion the plate came off with it. The magnet applies enough pressure to transfer the heat, but it's too much against the included glue. I recommend to remove it with a lever. Let's go quickly through the synthetic test. In Geekbench, the same as with the iPhone, almost identical results. But the multi-core performance dropped by almost 6%. Such is life on Geekbench on Android. In Wildlife Extreme, we had 2490 points without the cooler, and 2486 with it. Again, almost identical. And in Antutu, we went from 790,000 points without it, to 900,000 points with the cooler on, a significant increase thanks to the duration of this test. Where the difference is quite clear is in the stress test, where we went from having average scores within 1300 to an average score around 2000 points, with the stability up from 50% to 70%. Those are impactful changes. Let's see now if we can play Fortnite at full speed this way. First, we set the configuration to 60 frames, epic quality, and 75% 3D resolution. And, as we saw in the last video, without the cooler is simply not playable. It starts well, with average frame rates between 35 and 45, but quickly drops to frame rates where it looks cut off. And if your game drags on, things get scary. At the end, I could barely hold 15 FPS, which is unplayable. It's like playing with your eyes closed, and it didn't matter what game boost mode you use. The same thing happens in all of them. And now with the cooler, we start the game and it's a completely different story. It feels like a different phone. It starts at 60 FPS, although the counter showed that it sometimes goes down, but hardly noticeable to the naked eye. This makes it much easier to kill 1, 2, 3, 5 times. With more frames, it's much easier. Seriously, after the review of this phone, I would not have believed that it had the potential to run Fortnite like this. And obviously, we were not going to skip Genshin Impact. Without the cooler, things were very clear. It starts off hovering around 60 frames, but no matter what mode you are in, performance slowly drops until you are in the 30 FPS range, and stays there. With the cooler, we have the same story as Fortnite. It starts at 60 FPS, and after 5 minutes, it is still in the 60s. When you start moving to other areas, the frames may drop a little. I even saw it in the 40s, but it always bounced back and keep it between 50 and 60. A completely different experience from what we saw in the review. Amazing. With these results, I had to try some retro games. Without the fan, we could barely play PlayStation 2 at 1x, but cooled down, we can crank it up to 2x, 3x, even 4x, and it still runs at playable speeds. The change is impressive, and the same goes to Dolphin. The easiest GameCube games will run up to 4x without problems, and 3x for the hardest games and Wii games, 3 times more performance. Citroën runs between 2x and 4x all games, and PSP, 10x the easiest ones, and between 7x and 8x the hardest ones. Seriously amazing, I did not expect the change to be that big. If you have a Galaxy S22 and play games, here is the solution to every performance woe. I know that these are not results that put it in the same level of the Red Magic phones, but it gives you the possibility to get the most out of this phone. It's enough cooling that the processor can stretch its leg and roll at the speeds it should. Even more if you can put the phone aside and play it in DeX mode. This way you won't even hear the fan, which doesn't sound very loud anyway. A very big thumbs up to this accessory. Finally we have the price. It seems that most BLT coolers cost the same. I paid $45 for it, although I have seen it for less. And considering that it is not just a fan, but has a peltier, I think it's an acceptable price. As we saw in the test, it helps the performance on phones that get very hot, especially any Android that uses the Snapdragon 888 or 8 Gen 1. But you will have to glue it other way because the included glue is not strong enough. And remember that you cannot use it with a telescopic controller, and that the cooler must be connected. If you use an iPhone, the change might not be noticeable when playing games, but be sure it helps, especially if you constantly have temp locks. It is definitely a good option for those who game a lot, and the temperature is limiting their performance. Now, if you're one of those, also consider a gamer phone for your next buy. You'll get more performance without additional accessories. If you liked the video, don't forget to like and subscribe. And remember, retro games, modern technology, zero to tech.